$1.3 million going to the victor, and we are underway.
So getting out of here, remember, guys, Jeff getting Sylvanas and Andy getting Alquang. They have both been banned a ton, so all the cards are on the table. There have been a few marbles here and there, but the rest of them are up for grabs. This is an $800,000 game.
$1.3 million versus $500,000 are going to be the prizes between the first and second place teams.
Oh,
ladies and gentlemen, it's game number five. It's the grand finals here of the Smite World Championship Series. The blue team fighting out of the bottom side of the minimap, the left side of your spectator UI. They are the number two seed out of North America. They have the hometown favorite Barracuda. It is Kognitiv Gaming. And it's there in the jungle is Alquang. Barracuda as your hunter in the duo lane, matching up with Jeff Hinla on the Sylvanas. MLC Stealth in the mid lane on his signature Scylla. And that leaves Omegatron with the champion of Rome, Hercules. Their opponents today holding the number one seed in Europe, fighting out of the wild card bracket. They have battled back from a 2-0 game deficit. They're wearing the red trunks, fighting on the top side of the minimap and the right side of the spectator UI. It is Titan! Pretty Prime in the mid lane as Agni, Ataraxia as the Unicorn Apollo, Repikos in the jungle as Nemesis, Kanye Life as the support Athena, and Confrey reprising his role as Osiris in the solo lane.
So very curious to start. Pretty Prime opts to start on the speed side, helping his, his solo laner? This is very confusing. What this will do, though, is this will allow Ataraxia and Kamle to go into the lane at level two, the same thing that you're seeing from Barracuda and Jeff Hinla.
The left side duo lane here is where the action is going to be. It feels like Jeff Hinla and Barracuda, a lot of push coming out of that Sylvanas and on her. They can clear waves very, very efficiently. The Sylvanas Wisp, will she shoot out of the tree? They heal and give her protection bonus to the wave. Mid lane, though, Alquang is here to help hold off the pressure coming into MLC Self.
And this is good. I mean, he needs to be there maybe even earlier. Scylla, her earlier game does not have enough push to keep these creeps off the tower. And remember, if a tower hits a creep, it's no longer worth any gold.
Ooh, back camp's actually be started before the red buff here.
Wait, is Repikos splitting camps now? Like, I love it.
he decided in the World Championship Series he might as well be gold efficient. well, Repikos and Pretty Prime going to take the back camps as well as the red camps here. Shades of Kognitiv Prime's earlier games against Titan here and how they pulled ahead. No clear victory yet in the early part of the laning stage as it's been a basically identical start so far.
Yeah, both red buffs get taken. The entire jungle, barring the two mirrored small camps on the bottom and top side of your minimap, have been taken. That's very efficient and rather a little bit dire, it seems.
We'll take a quick moment here before the action breaks out just to thank all the viewers wherever you're watching from, however you may be watching us. If you're here live in the Cobb Energy Center, at home, on Twitch, anywhere in the world watching, thank you very much for joining us here today. This has been a big kind of establishment for all of us here at Smite, and we hope that you learn to love Smite Esports in the years to come. Oh. But let's get back to the game.
Comfrey, speaking of gambles there, Comfrey took a lot of damage there from the Tier 1 tower as Omega does find a beautiful pull. 2 seconds still, he can try it again. Hand of the Gods to clear the wave. He doesn't quite have the line. He turned around.
Oh, he got him. Comfrey being pushed around. Back. Now it's going to take about 10 auto attacks to take him down, though. The Splinter Flail is going to give him enough speed to move out.
Expect big rotations here from both Repi and Andy. They're going to need to rotate to the right.
Yeah, this is looking like it's going to be a little bit of a slow pace early game. 2.5 minutes in, no kills to the credit of either team.
Right now, left side continuously, Ataraxia is pushed underneath his tower. This is a good mix of on her having very decent clear and Jeff Hinla's character Sylvanas being able to use wisps to heal up to his creep wave, which allows them to push super, super hard.
The giant tree, the little man riding the giant tree is actually the Sylvanas. And look for the AoE ultimate to come out. It's a big knockup. But as we approach the 3-minute mark, the camps on either side of the mid lane are going to respawn. And this will be a big point of contention. Oh. At about the 3-minute, 15-second mark, they're going to come up. Jeff Hinla leaves the lane from the left side, rotating in. Kanye Life and Repikos are going to meet him in the jungle. This could be your first blood.
Oh, they're going for the kill. Divine Ruin, Destruction going down. Divine Judgment finds it. First blood goes to Europe, but the fight's not over. Dashing in, Andy is in so much trouble.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
A very, very questionable leap in, but Barracuda comes
through. I'm a monster!
MLC Self 1! There's a second one coming through, doing tons of damage to Titan. It's still a 2-for-1 trade in favor of the boys of Europe, but Kognitiv, they stop the bleeding there and get a return kill of their own.
All right, so they do drop two, including the first blood, but somehow are only down 100 gold.
Yeah, it'll go back a little bit more in favor of Titan as the mid camps go down on the right side in their favor. And, well, all things told, a lot of excitement, but not a lot of real advantage gain for either team.
Right, that's true. Though there is a small amount of experience being gained here, it has leveled out, though it is slightly in favor of Titan, as is the gold. It should be noted that no team has an actual advantage right now.
As we approach the 4-minute mark, you see those early buffs getting ready to respawn, indicated by the Pac-Man signs all over the map. At about 4 minutes, 15 to 30 seconds, you're gonna see these buffs coming back up. We'll see if there's gonna be any kind of invade shenanigans going on here in the early game.
Right side, it looks like Humphrey is hanging out by himself. There was a back from Omegatron, who of course has purchased teleport. Hopefully he doesn't run out of mana and regret that.
I do want to point out that this first blood came out on the back of Jeff Hinla, and that Jeff makes basically the same rotation at the same time in every single game.
Right.
And that's just Titan doing their homework and saving that pickoff for when they really needed it here in game 5.
You know, and that's honestly, that's what I was very confused about, is I saw a 3-man grouping from Titan, and I expected them to rotate to right for the free camp, but instead they go immediately left and they just rush down Jeff. Obviously, their homework has paid off. Andy in the mid lane now, going for blood.
This is why you draft the Nemesis here. And well, the Alquan, we're gonna need to hear something out of him fairly soon, because Repikos has already flexed his muscles and shown us what he can do versus those tanky targets.
Right.
And they have a Hercules on the side of Cognitive that's gonna be very, very difficult to play, given that there's a Nemesis in this game.
Andy just randomly threw out his 3 on a red buff that was nowhere near spawn. That'll be on cooldown for a little while. It does have a very short cooldown.
It's on a 5-second cooldown.
Yeah, it's very short.
Of course, he's maxing the Dragon Call on Alquan. That is the swirling dragons around him. And just for a little bit of information here, we haven't
again,
seen
Jeff is
thought.
Dead.
Yeah, Jeff's going to go down.
Oh,
now.
Maybe not.
Bomb, third bomb. Is there a dot active? Death
healing, boys.
Now. Slice and dice.
Wow.
Not enough.
Repi's dead.
I'm a monster. No! It's there, but here comes the dragon. Nom, nom, nom.
Eating it up. Is he going to go deep? No, going to go back to the red buff. Jeff Finla just barely escaping. Specifically, and this is going to be the third time in the set that I cite this, Pretty Prime does not go in with his team far enough. Whether he didn't believe in himself or he didn't believe in his team, he just dropped a kill.
Omegatron makes his way back to the solo lane, where he squares off against the Lord of the Afterlife, Osiris. Well, normally the solo lane, when you have these two bruisers like this, it ends up being just a bit of a slap fight, and that's exactly what you're seeing here. They just trade blows, clearing waves, and playing for the mid game is generally what you see out of the solo lane tanks.
So Gold Fury is still available, 6 minutes, no real attempts. In fact, there haven't really been any wards there at all. Aside from regular wards, there are no sentries in the inventory right now for Titan, comparatively to Cognitive, where you can find 2.
And then, sir, he gets a little bit of harass coming up, but not a lot of damage. Pretty Prime, not enough mana nor meteors to follow that one up in reality. But here, as we approach 6.5 minutes, mid-camp's going to respawn again, and it looks like the left side's going to be aggressed by Titan. Anisir may find himself in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, he's going to try to go in here, and he's going to fight for this. He's going right after Revy because Jeff's there.
And this fight continues to break out. Anisir gets a lot of damage out on Repikos. It's the slow as well. He throws out his number 3. They're going to move forward with Scylla. Can't you find the root? No, it's just a crush, and their damage is going to be returned by Repikos.
Yeah, he'll answer that back immediately. Left camp guaranteed to go to the boys on Cog. They should group up and go right. Hercules already making a beautiful rotation, and the Hand of the Gods is available. Cog's going to get both camps this time around.
Yeah, it's going to help them out overcome the early disparity that they've built up, and now they're going to take the gold and experience lead for the first time this game.
Where are they going here? They're rushing down Repi. Repi's forced to actually stop his back. He's going to dash away there. Just barely. Andy getting very low on mana. Should be careful.
Confounds on cooldown.
Jeff is back, and the ultimate is available.
The Sylvanas ult here, we've only seen it used defensively so far in this game. We need to see that offensive use of the ability to start breaking down the defenses of Titan.
All right, so coming in, beautiful shot coming out from Jeff. Nature's Grasp, not an easy shot to hit. MLC Stealth not believing in himself there and choosing not to go into I'm a Monster for the kill. Had he done that, it would have been almost guaranteed, given the fact that Agni only has Aegis, and if he missed it, that would have been a 3-minute cooldown versus a minute and a half. I would have taken that one.
Yeah, that's right. That Aegis Amulet, only at rank 1, is that 3-minute cooldown, as you mentioned. I'm a Monster is a base cooldown of just 90 seconds, so it's a very, very good trade, although it doesn't have the high impact play that you're looking for necessarily on paper. It does definitely make Agni play the lane much, much less aggressively if his Aegis Amulet is down.
That's correct. Speaking of Agni, you're going to see him rotating towards the top side. Pretty Prime level 9 right now, comparatively, of course, to MLC Stealth, the monster, finding level 10 pretty early.
All things told here, looking at this game, Osiris has been left alone for just a moment here. He's going to peek forward and see if he can maybe steal away a blue buff. As you see, once again, we passed the 8.5-minute mark, so camps, if you haven't figured it out by now, we're on a 4-minute timer, and they are coming back up. You can see as Cognitive is looking for an invade here.
Oh, they see it. They see it. Are we going to see a rotation again? Jeff Hinla becomes the recipient of the Divine Judgment. Repikos is going to be able to blow that one through. Defender of Olympus, Jeff's going to go down here.
Yeah, he's gonna fall, but can the wraparound come from Cognitive and find the extra kills? Ataraxia coming across the sky, and Cognitive have overcommitted. Anister finds one kill. MLC Self is looking for the same one. The double execute not playing to their favor. Anister falling back down now.
Omega Strike finds the power of
Trinity Prime. Boulder 2, 1,
Boulder,
boom, 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 boom. Godfrey in some trouble. Down he goes as well. Anister finds yet another kill, and Barracuda can chase out Kanye Life.
Preemptive strike is up, and so is Sonic Strike. They came up at the same time. Omega finds the kill. Turn your sights to the big harpy. Mama Gold Fury gonna get taken down, and Cognitive will extend their lead by 1500.
This is a really, really important moment in this game. Jeff Hinla gets spotted out again by the Nemesis Ultimate. He did evade a death one time, which transitioned him into being able to pressure the map again. He dies there, but Cognitive makes up for his death by finding four kills of their own and makes that trade excellent. What will happen in this situation, more often than not, is that the support on the side of Cognitive just gets so far behind that he can never have impact in the game, and they are keeping Jeff Hinla in this one. And honestly, I think your analysis of the last game was correct. Jeff is not playing at the level we're used to seeing from him.
To be fair, this game, he is getting tunneled out. Every single Nemesis ult has been completely used on him, and from here on out, I think that's a bad idea. They must now turn their sights to Omega. We need to see the Weakening Curse come online here, and it has to be soon.
Right side, Replicas gonna start up these mid camps. Pretty fine to be here as well. Jeff Hinla, nope, he'll probably favor his life with this one again. Wrath of Terror coming out trying to save himself.
I don't know.
Replicas is here, the Athena as well, but rooted in
place. I don't know.
The dash stopped as well. Kanye Life now comes in. Replicas takes a spill, and this is out of control. Trying to run away is Kanye Life. The dash is good, but
it
is Godfrey. He gets banished out by the Outquang, and there it's a full under retreat from Kong.
He's trying to find it. The sickle hits the wall, and he will be able to escape once again, finding the jungler. Replicas has got to stop the tunnel vision. It's just a tree.
And then, sir, well, Outquang has been banned in every game so far in this best of five matchup. He gets through one game. He's 4-1-3 through the first 11 minutes. Taukein's ring complete. It is just a lot of trouble for Titans.
Now, what Taukein's ring will do, and I know that most of you will probably have not seen that this tournament, but we'll talk about that in a second. Annie with a beautiful escape. Jeff Hinla goes down. Annie able to reciprocate. Bomb from the back. Pretty Prime waiting on cooldowns. He doesn't have anything. Why is he getting so baited?
He's going to get dunked by Barracuda here.
Why is he getting so baited?
Desert Fury picks up one kill. Ataraxia does find MLC Stealth. They go for a one-for-one trade, but the trades are not what Titan needs. They need some safe farm. They need to help get themselves back into this game. They've gone down 3,000 experience and 2,200 gold.
Bart, you need to explain to me why Pretty Prime will not go into fights with all of his cooldowns, but will go into fights with none of them.
Well, they were calling for the rotation from Ataraxia, who's coming across the sky. They do convert the kill into Scylla, but it is one of those but at what cost situations.
Yeah, definitely. So Tier 1 taking some damage despite the fact that Cog won the fight. It seems to be that they're not quite winning the lane until just now. Andy sending a lot of damage in. Omega not finding what he needed to continue the pressure, but still the damage being done. There's still a 2,200 gold difference, and Omega greedily stealing the wave away.
Yeah, so this Taukein's ring is an interesting item. It gives you 40 additional flat damage anytime an enemy is hit by one of your basic attacks.
Right.
And the Wild Storm, his number 3, counts as a basic attack for Anister. But let's hold our thoughts as the Wrath of Terror comes out from the Sylvanas, but it's just a disengage. So I'll go back and explain it again. 50% scaling on the Wild Storm. He's only sitting on about 100 magical power, which is translated into 50 extra damage. The Taukein's is giving him an additional 40 on top of that, flat, as well as 45 magical power. It ends up being a very, very cost-efficient item, but basically only on this god.
Plus, he has an extremely unique attack chain, hitting at a normal rate of 1 second and then 0.5 seconds thereafter for a few more hits, meaning he can apply that 40 damage over and over. And you couple that with the fact that he's doing damage with those dragons that you're seeing on the left side get slammed into Ataraxia. It winds up being a lot of damage very quickly and is actually one of the strongest characters in the game for burning down Gold Fury and Fire Giant.
The Gold Fury is going to be back up in about a minute and a half. Mid-camp's coming up very, very shortly here, about 15 seconds on the left side, 20 on the right side, as the teams, you can see, coalescing towards the mid lane. Anister continually looking for some poke.
Blinking in there. Jeff again finds a raw nature's grasp, doing a lot of damage. Andy not getting the blink he needed. Kanye is still alive. MLC stealth whipping the armor monster. Replicas in a deep spot here, trying to find a kill, but I think he's only going to find mortality.
Oh, MLC stealth cleans that one up with a crush. It was a three-man fist of the gods out of that Nemesis, though.
Yeah, again, you know, it looks like Pretty Prime is not choosing the right times to go in and out. He's not relying on his team enough.
The nerves. It's got to be. I mean, he's been such a cool, collected player so far, that's but true. You're right. I mean, there's definitely some missed opportunities on the board here.
What is it, $160,000 per player extra for winning this game?
Yeah, that's a few years of salary as someone with a college degree. So.
Pretty much anything ever. Yeah,
that's worth it. And when you're a young gentleman like these guys are, it's a lot of pressure, a lot of just nerves, and a lot of money on the line here.
So 10-6 right now. Cognitive maintains their lead but does not extend it. 2,700 gold, 3,800 experience will separate the teams as Cognitive at the 14-minute mark keeps their hold so far. But remember, guys, late game, Hercules is a monster. Osiris can catch back up. Scylla, literally a monster, whereas Agni has some of the highest scaling in the game. The only real advantage they have here is in the end game, Apollo will be able to box just a tad bit better than, of course, on her.
Yeah, one thing that's going on here for Titan, even though they're playing from behind, it's not a big deficit as of yet. They have a pretty decent team for four-manning, letting this Apollo split push and find his farm and then ratting the game out a little bit. I think one of the biggest issues, though, is that Osiris and Nemesis are both melee. Even though the Nemesis is fairly mobile, they're going to have a little bit of trouble in these team fights getting kited by especially the Scylla and the Sylvanas. A lot of roots coming out of the Sylvanas and
oh,
wow.
My lord. Yikes. But as it spells, if you rotate to duo, rotate to solo, you mess up on duo. Can they keep Jeff Hinla at bay? That's the name of the game. They're trying to keep him out here. He's working his way in. It's getting lower and lower and lower. And Titan does find it, but MLC finds a kill.
No, he gets a double kill off that one. A triple kill off of that one. MLC stealth has just shut down Titan at the goal. Fury.
That's going to be big. They should take the Fire Giant.
Yeah, they can definitely get Fire Giant here.
Oh, no, the Hand of the Gods was used. They're going to go for the Tier 2. They'll trade out the 1,500 gold for what will be very, very close to 3,000.
Look at the faces on the player cams there. Cognitive focus and locked in. Omegatron moving forward, tanking the tower. Pretty Prime, it can only look as his Tier 2 in the mid lane will fall at the 15-minute mark. They're going to take a Tier 1 on the left as well. Osiris from Titan ports into the right side to try to get any kind of trade, but it's just not going to be enough. 2,000 gold going the way of Titan on the push. So far, it's another 500 as well. They've recouped that Gold Fury in spades.
Gonfrey going to be forced to back as the rotation comes out from Andy and Omegatron. He goes back and the teleport is on cooldown, so don't expect him to have any quick way back to the lane. He'll probably split this small camp. No, again, Replicas not waiting for anyone.
And even though we've called his name a lot in this game, it's very hard to overstate how much impact Anister has had on the Zhao Quang. He's been absolutely a nightmare for Titan to deal with. He's been bursting down gods to 50% before they even knew he was there. And one of the major strengths of this god, he's a short range, long duration blink. So he blinks forward, going invisible, and he stays invisible for about 8 seconds. And that is really what's allowing him to reposition so effectively in these fights.
So Ring Boy's coming out as he goes back into the Enchanted Ring, going for Demonic Grip, another basic attack. Scheduled item. What this is going to do is every time he basic attacks, it will decrease penetration, or increases penetration, or rather decrease protections by a very significant margin, stacking up to 3 times.
Yeah, he's looking to just explode targets. One thing that is working a little bit against Cog, and you've seen it come into effect in a couple team fights, is that they have 2 executes on this team, and both of them won it. But here we go. Atarax in a lot of trouble as the damage comes channeling from Anister. He's going to throw out the slow. I'm a monster activated. There goes the damage.
Oh,
MLC stealth! He shuts out Ataraxia! What a player! What a play! Waits for the damage reduction from Athena to drop off and blows up the carry.
No problem for MLC. It looks like a good play, but it's just Sunday to him. He's really working on that MVP status as he continues to pressure the enemy Titan and, of course, extend his team's lead now 5-2-7.
And 6-1-5 on the Ao Quang as well over on the side of Titan. The ray of hope is that there's only 2 deaths on the Agni and the Apollo piece, but the Agni has been really shut down this game, only sitting at level 14, 1 level ahead of the enemy support.
Right now, Replicas is having a little bit of trouble. 1-6 has been picked off a lot and continuously by the bait of Jeff Hinla. It's always because he's trying to chase that tree down.
That's right, yeah. And they've secured a few kills on a Jeff, 1, 3, and 7. But he's got 7 assists to his credit. He got a kill as well. And he's a support, and he's got his levels. So all they sold, Ao Quang right side. Nom 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 nom. Down goes the Osiris. The true lord of the afterlife is here as he brings the pain.
Eating him up, sending him back for another 45 seconds. Gonfrey feeling the hurt. This is why you have not seen Ao Quang play this weekend. He absolutely shreds through Warriors. Jeff Hinla rotating in there just to keep Scylla safe. They're going to push up the right side, guys. Cognitive is not looking phased.
The final tier one has fallen. One tier two remaining on the right side, one on the left side. Left side being pressured by Barracuda, being defended by Ataraxia from Titan. The right side, Cognitive is grouped here, and they're going to port Omegatron into this ward, and they're going to make it a four-man push down the right side. What can Titan do to hold out the hunger of Cognitive Gaming?
It's going to have to come down to the Fire Giant. We've seen Titan get a few wipes there before. You know that's what they're baiting for. They've got to be calling, guys, we got to bait. Guys, we got to farm. Don't fight. Don't fight. Replicas hold that ultimate, like, don't get baited by it. We have to wait until they go for an objective, and we have to fight with the assistance of the map.
On her farming up his blue buff here, just casually, Barracuda doing what he does best and throwing spears as on her safely, without dying, finding one kill and eight assists, the top assists in the game on the back of Barracuda.
I did not think the lead was this significant. 7,200 gold, 12,000 experience.
I didn't either.
When did that happen?
12,000 experience in favor of Cog 20 minutes into this match. Level 17 on Andy, level 18 on Barra, level 18 on Stealth, level 18 on Omegatron, and they're fighting into level 11s on the side of Titan.
That's true. I mean, honestly, what are we going to see here? Confrey 17, Ataraxia 17, fine. Pretty Prime, level 16, does not have access to his level 4 ultimate. That's going to be a big hindrance to his damage.
It's going to be a Spirit Road coming out from Nemesis here. She's going to drastically drop her damage here, and the Magi's Blessing would allow her to stay more mobile. She's just trying not to get exploded.
Yeah, honestly, I think she's going to be building into tank. She's going to rely on the damage coming out from Agni. Again, why Agni? I just don't understand.
It just slows down her chin size so much.
Yeah, we're not going to see them for another 15 minutes, maybe 20.
Yeah, 3,000 gold to purchase that item, and he's not farming that fast. Gold Fury being started once again by Cog, and there's just no response coming out of Titan here. Titan, they may realize that their backs are up against the wall here as the Gold Fury goes down once again, the second of the match in favor of Cognitive.
The arena lights up in gold lights as we're going to see an extended lead. 8,800 gold as Barracuda procs into 19, two levels ahead of Ataraxia, the only person on his team aside from Agni who remains an even score or better, both of whom are 2-2.
Oh, Brandon, this one is feeling like it's slipping away from Titan. Cognitive, the presence of mind to go down or go up two games, lose two straight, and then find it within themselves to pull out this draft that guarantees them the Alquang. It feels like this one they were keeping in their pocket for an elimination game.
Honestly, I just don't understand how this draft came about. I mean, this is the dream. Hercules is the most winningest solo laner, most likely at least, in the matches of the SPL. MLC Stealth has had Scylla banned away from her repeatedly this day. We've seen Barracuda do nothing but great things on her, and right now,
Kanye life in a lot
Andy
of trouble.
Fighting two people freely.
Yeah, that shouldn't happen as an Alquang. He's got a very, very low HP pool. He should be able to explode him here.
That was really rough. Replicas uses Divine Judgment, and again, Pretty Prime does not access any of his damage whatsoever. I don't know what he had up, but he's just not spending his abilities in the right spot.
Confrey recalling underneath the tier one on the right side. It's not going to fall here as the minion wave comes in. Omegatron going to clear this one out. Up the left side are the damage dealers from Cog. The Tri-Core is here. Sylvanas in the mid lane continuing to push it up. Ataraxia trying to defend this tower, but his tier two is going to fall on the left side to Barracuda, and down it goes. Cognitive, there's only one tower remaining for Titan. Two Phoenixes exposed. 16 kills to 6. 22 minutes into this game. $1.3 million their prize if they can just find that Titan.
10,000 gold at 22 minutes. That is the difference between these two teams right now, and it's becoming increasingly relevant as Stealth already has hit level 20, has access to his last level of ultimate, which is currently hitting for more damage than should ever be in a video game.
Scylla sitting on, so the way her passive works is that for each ability that she maxes out, she gains additional magical power. Because of that, is sitting at 432 magical power currently. To put this in perspective, I'm sorry, it is 190 power for the Agni, the mid lane mage on the other side of the map.
So her ultimate will actually hit somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,300 damage unmitigated.
And instead of putting out the burst on a Replicas, Pretty Prime, he's going to be in some trouble. No, the crush just a bit off the mark.
Anya
Life is here, but he's rooted out.
They got to get Andy
coming
now.
In. They're going to try for Andy. He's got the sprint activated. Confrey gets stunned out by Barracuda. He just is in the perfect spot right now. Kanye is here, but the Desert Fury is activated. They can't taunt him out. On the right side, the boulder comes wrecking through Ataraxia. Pretty Prime forced out of the fight. Confrey pulled back in. MLC Stealth is here with the burst. And down goes Confrey!
Repagoss not finding the target here. Kanye Life going to be taken down as well. Cognitive will turn their sights to the Fire Giant as Omega backs with 3 seconds remaining on teleport. He'll be right in there very, very quickly. Fist of the Gods activated right now onto Nemesis, was used in the last fight. No other hand on the table. This means for everyone watching at home, the Fire Giant will be done. The damage will be increased, and Cognitive is primed to take home the World Championship.
This is a team that no one thought had a chance at the finals coming into this event. Coming as a number two team. Down, ripping through, Titan down, falls three, a double kill for himself, it's a 5-8, they're gonna go further away, pushing down the mid lane, is Kong looking for $1.3 million, and this could be it.
Kanye and Confree gonna have to team up to stop them from rushing this down. I just don't know how they can stop the five. One tower remains as one Phoenix falls, and they're gonna go for it.
Ladies and gentlemen,
champions. Cognitive Prime,